morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. Today is a wild and wicked Wednesday. It's Wednesday.
Yeah, it is.
It's Wednesday, yeah, and Wednesday. I'm wearing black and gold, my wild and wicked Loretta Lynn shirt. I wanted to honor, once again, the living legends of country music, which are Connie Smith, Donna Fargo, Aaron Tippin, but the lost legends of the amazing industry of country music, mm-hmm. Charley Pride, George Jones, Merle Haggard, Billy Joe Royal, B.J. Thomas, Earl Thomas Conley, and the Queen, the never underestimate Loretta Lynn. So today we are honoring, and Donavan is here with me. Donavan is a young soul, but he's an old soul when it comes to music.
Yeah, old soul. It started with Elvis when I was younger, and
yeah.
We got to pick a vacation for the family, and guess where we went?
Graceland, of course.
Graceland.
Of
yep.
course, of
yep.
course.
We did the whole tour of Memphis, did yeah. Sun Studios. The only memory I have of it, though, because I was so little, is I remember at Sun Studios, my grandmother went with us, Marlene Jones.
Yes.
She was standing over in the side, and they were like, that's exactly where
Elvis
would
stood
every single time. She was right there where the mic went and everything.
Oh, how cool is
yeah.
that? How cool
yeah,
is
yeah,
that?
Yeah.
Today, celebrating, Loretta Lynn has joined the Angel Band. And when we think about the Angel Band, it consists of Charley Pride, George Jones, Merle Haggard, Billy Joe Royal, B.J. Thomas, Earl Thomas Conley, Patsy Cline.
Mm-hmm.
So many people that without them, country music would not be country music without
oh, no.
the legend Hank Sr.
Mm-hmm.
And recently we have seen Dwight Sanford doing, revitalizing the old Hank Sr. songs I've never heard.
Yeah.
But one of them is Your Burden is Greater Than Mine, and that, every time I hear it now, I tear up. And yesterday, I was driving down the road, and I saw something happen, and I thought, their burden is greater than mine, no matter what I'm facing. So if you're not listening to old country music, you need to be listening to old country music. Let me tell you what you're going to listen to today. Old country music. I'm so excited. Donavan, I found, these are my go-to songs, and one is Saint to a Sinner by Loretta Lynn. We're going to play some George Jones, some Merle Haggard, some Loretta Lynn.
I wish you would have told me, because if you remember, I took Mama's
yes.
To Donna Fargo and got it autographed.
Yes, you did, and I
yeah.
did not bring a Donna Fargo, but
yeah.
we are going to show some of the interview, and can we just say in 14 years of doing interviews with country music legends, the camera work we use has changed greatly,
oh, yeah.
hasn't
greatly.
It?
Yes.
The microphones
yes.
we use have changed greatly.
Greatly.
Yes,
yeah.
greatly. And we see things changing every single day. But I want to start today's program with something that this is in honor of everybody who ever lost someone they loved. But this is my tribute to my legend, my amazing woman who got me through the days that I thought I'll never make it. And then Loretta would come out with a song and I'd say, oh, well, she's lived it too. So here you go. Her journey's just begun. Don't think of her as gone away. Her journey's just begun. Life holds so many facets. This earth is only one. Just think of her as resting from the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days and years. Think how she must be wishing that we could know today that nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of her as living in the hearts of those she touched, for nothing loved is ever lost, and she was loved so much.
Mm-hmm.
Loretta Lynn has to have been, I mean, like, she's the one we all went to as single women, as married women, as women in the workforce, as women trying to break into country music. So many of the women we hear today, Martina McBride, you know, I look at those young women who followed in her footsteps. Without Loretta Lynn, there would be no country music for women.
Now, here in Georgia, where would they all play?
Oh,
do you
they
remember?
Would play, yes, in Marietta at...
No, over in Cumming.
At Cumming, Lanierland. Yes,
yep.
Lanierland, that's right.
Yeah.
And then there was a place over in Calhoun, Georgia. And I can't remember the name of that park. And then Hiawassee at Anderson
mm-hmm.
Music Hall. And I've said this before, Loretta Lynn is the reason that Anderson Music Hall is air conditioned, because she would wear those big poofy dresses and she would sweat. And she told him, she said, if y'all want me back up here, you better get
mm-hmm.
you some air conditioning. And they did. So, but her journey has just begun, and she joins, Loretta Lynn joined the Angel Band with Charley Pride, George Jones, Merle Haggard, Billy Joe Royal, B.J. Thomas, Earl Thomas Conley, Patsy Klein, so many who have gone on before her. So many. I think about Jim Ed Brown. He was on Larry's Country Diner. Do you watch Larry's Country Diner? Mm-mm. Well, it's a plus at the house. I love it. I just love it. And he was on there. And there are so many people who honestly are just gone just like this. Charley Pride had COVID. I interviewed Charley Pride. And what a treasure. So today we're going to share some of the interviews we've done. And I will just tell y'all, I'm very proud of the fact that you, our viewers, and our YouTube viewers have taken us over 205,000 hits on the Loretta Lynn special. And it's called Loretta Lynn, Coal Miner's Daughter, Daughters. And people are responding to this and saying, I didn't know Sissy could sing so much like her mother. Mm-hmm. Well, she sounds just like her mother. So how did y'all not know that as her fans? But Sissy is such a precious, precious lady. And Sissy survived. She had cancer a few years ago. Her sister, Betty Sue, sadly, after we interviewed her, went to be with the Lord. And she had breathing issues. And the day I was interviewing her, she said, I had some problems with my breathing. And then, sadly, she went away. But now her mother's there, her daddy's there, Conway Twitty's there. And today we're going to share some really cool 45 records. Now, do you have your mom's record collection?
I have all my mom's, all my grandmother's, all my aunt's, because
wow.
Aunt Donna.
Mm-hmm.
And then I remember whenever I got my first turntable, we were over at my grandmother's, the new house
uh-huh.
where she lived.
Right.
And mom was like, okay, get in the car, let's go. It was like 3 o'clock in the morning because we just got up and opened gifts and everything.
Uh-huh.
And she took me to Nana's old house in the back of Papa's old closet. There sat a tub with all of Donna's and hers records and everything. And
how
I went
cool
through.
Is that?
Some of them they had doubles up because they both loved the album.
Mm-hmm,
so, like,
mm-hmm.
we had two of the greatest hits of the Eagles
yeah,
whenever it came
yeah,
out. So, there's
yeah.
two of those. My personal favorite is I have a album that's the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Heart Club Band.
Yes, yes.
But it's actually
painted. We know somebody who would love that.
Yes, but it's actually painted on the record itself.
Oh.
So I've got it framed up and everything.
Oh, how cool is that?
Mama said, I don't think Donna ever played it.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't look like it's ever been played because you could see the scratches in it
right.
and everything. But
right.
I've still got it.
That is cool. That
yeah.
is too cool.
Yeah.
yeah. And when you look at musical memories, you know, without the music, without our life would not be what it has
oh,
been.
No.
And you know, in editing, when you're editing an interview, you have background music behind
mm-hmm.
it. And often the music you choose makes the interview
right.
happen.
Yeah, so like while we were in college, they emphasized like how much sound and music can drive something and make it sound completely different.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the projects that we did, we had to take a comedy film
mm-hmm.
and then edit into a horror film, make it look like a horror
oh
film.
Oh my gosh, you're kidding.
So it's just the trailer. And so what I did Mrs. Doubtfire.
Mm-hmm. I love that movie.
But you can make it look like a horror film easily.
Oh my gosh.
Just put the sounds to it.
Yeah.
It looks like a horror film.
That is crazy.
So yeah.
That is crazy. Well, today we're talking about editing and we're talking about how things change. And one of the things that I want to share is I did an interview with Truman Roach. It's 5 minutes. It's going to be a 5-minute interview. The interview was about 18 minutes, but we are editing down to 5 minutes because that's the rule and regulation for the competition it's going to be entered in.
Mm-hmm.
In order to take 18 minutes with pauses and stops because he couldn't hear very well and we had a little bit of trouble communicating, and then I went to Smoky Holler and took pictures, we're editing all this. In order to edit an 18-minute program, it's going to take over a day and a half of work.
Mm-hmm.
Because by the time you correct any flaw, and we want it to be flawless, we want it to win the competition. So it takes a lot of effort, doesn't it?
Yeah, it takes a lot of effort. I usually say, like a day of shooting, you should look at 2 to 3 days of edit,
mm-hmm.
up to a week, depending
yeah.
on
yeah,
if
absolutely.
You want cleanup work, because you can get rid of mistakes, if you,
mm-hmm.
there's power lines, that sort of stuff. Like
mm-hmm.
you actually go in and start doing, I'll tell this funny story. So I did a commercial for Tanger Outlet
mm-hmm.
that, and the owner of Tanger Outlet loves to be in his commercials,
mm-hmm.
but he wants to be with all these supermodels.
Oh, wow.
He's super old now.
Oh, how funny.
And he's got extra skin hanging down from his neck
oh, how
and
funny.
Everything. So we were editing and we get into the final correction of cleanup and everything. And then out of nowhere, he's like, can y'all get rid of that?
Oh my gosh.
So we had to go in and get rid of his neck completely, put a whole new collar on his suit, track it in. And it looks clean, but like now he has to have it done every single time.
Oh, that's funny.
Because that's what he wants to look
like. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I want you to make me really thin. But I got to say this, and I got to tell y'all again, I was on steroids for years, and I came off steroids. And so everybody's like, are you sick? Are you sick? You look pale. You look thinner. Okay. I came off steroids. And so my breathing is really paying the price for that. Mm-hmm. And for everybody who's really worried about me, I'm really cool. I'm really good. But I did choose to come off the steroids, which adds a ton of weight. And it was tough because it has changed my breathing and it's given me a hard time. Mm-hmm. So no, I'm not dying, y'all. I'm not dying. Yesterday, we paid tribute to everybody who is battling cancer. And I have some photos today that I want to share with y'all. And this is to our angel spirit lead singer, Selena Hales. This is a tribute to her. She went up to Dollywood, not to Dollywood. She went up to Pigeon Forge and met with and visited with Kaylee Senior Davis, Bill Senior, you know, my co-host that y'all all loved because he was really mean to me and got me all the time. And I actually paid him to do that, y'all. I said, Bill, you gotta be mean to me because people love that. So Selena went up to visit with them, and we have some photos of Selena and her and Bill and with Melissa, and they went up to visit. And they are at the location where the Southern Gospel Music Hall of Fame is now located because Dollywood didn't renew their lease. And that was really, really tough because they had tons and tons of memorabilia of the Southern Gospel Music years and years and years, from Vestal Goodman to the Jake Hess. They had all this stuff, and they had nowhere to put it. So Kaylee's father-in-law owns this amazing business, and it's called Feasters on...
It's a dinner theater, isn't
Feasters
it?
Feasters on Teasters, is that right? Or Teasters
it
on Feasters.
Right, but isn't it a dinner theater?
They do have a Bible dinner theater.
Yeah.
And so it has worked perfectly to move all the Southern Gospel stuff. So, Trace, can we pull those pictures up of Selena? There you go. There's Kaylee and her sweet daddy. And Bill, you know him and love him. He is starring in one of the Bible productions up there. And it's really, really cool because you talk about editing. Mm-hmm. They film him without the rest of the cast. And then they, what do you call it, impose him in there? What do you call that?
Compliment.
Yeah, well, they put him in the deal, so it's really, really cool. So there's Kaylee and her daddy, and then there's Selena and Kaylee and Rick, and they were visiting, and they had a great, great visit, and I'm sure they had some great, great food because that's what that restaurant is known for. So, and there's Miss Melissa with Selena, and y'all, please continue to pray for Selena. She is up against it, but she is going to fight to the every day of her life. She's going to fight, and we're going to pray that she fights her way through this horrible cancer. And I can just say Satan delivers cancer, I think. Now, we're going to have a couple of yard sales coming up in the next week or so, and I'm going to be out at the cabin across from Ace Hardware here in LJ with Dwight's t-shirts and hats and his CDs, and we have a special going, 5 for $45. So if you buy 5 of his CDs, you get 5 for $45. And they're great gifts. And if you live in LJ or you have relatives from LJ, but we also have, I have the estate collection of one of my very, very favorite people. And Joan went to be with the Lord, and we have some of her pieces that we're going to be selling. She loved Fenton glassware almost as much as I do. And she and I both had a very extensive collection. And we have some of her pieces available there at the cabin. So stop by the cabin. I'll be there Friday and Saturday. And then Dwight will be performing at the Apple Festival from 1 to 3. And we'll be there again. Same special on the CDs, 5 for 45. So stop and get 5 of his CDs. Give some away. Make them your Christmas gifts. Put them in your car and play them often. Because that's what the world is about. We're about listening to music that makes us feel good. And that, his Christmas CD, oh my gosh, it's fantastic. And when you hear the song, the true song, about the police officer working on Christmas Day, you will be touched. You will be touched. Okay, going to be another big, huge yard sale in Hinton Friday and Saturday. And if you men sitting out there like to fish, don't tell Lonnie, but a bunch of Lonnie Fountain's fishing stuff is going to be there for sale. No, we're kidding. Lonnie knows it's going to be there. He has some reels that are really, really cool. He has some stuff that's really, really cool. And we want y'all to come out. It's going to be Friday starting at 8 a.m. and Friday and Saturday at the Hinton Community Building, right there in the 136 and 136 connector at Hinton, across from Hinton Milling. So check that out. There's any and everything you can imagine, from new clothes, $5, new tags on them, everything, just tons and tons of stuff. So check that out. You can go to Dawn's Facebook page, Cherokee Dawn Fountain, and check that out. And then Friday and Saturday at 261 Roy Haynes Drive in Ball Ground, there's going to be a really, really big sale to benefit Dominic's Mission. And this is, a lot of people in Ball Ground have brought stuff there, and it's going to be, oh my gosh, there's so much stuff. I hope that the driveway is big enough to put it all out there, because there's a whole bunch of stuff. So any and everything you're looking for. I did see some really cool bedding for little girls' beds. There's just a lot of stuff there. But thank you to everybody in the community who has helped and who has volunteered. And again, this benefits Dominic's Mission. And the money raised there stays in Cherokee County and helps people with, I don't know if you've looked at the grocery store bills lately, but bills are, it's crazy. It's crazy to go buy just the staples. So if you are in need of groceries, Dominic's Mission delivers and gives their groceries away on Saturday morning right there in Ball Ground. So anyway, okay, we're going to have those sales. And then again, I'm going to be over at the cabin on Friday and Saturday, and I hope you'll stop by. And I love that y'all are loving these T-shirts, because the T-shirts are really cool. It took a lot of time, a lot of effort, and a lot of planning to make the shirt exactly what the man wanted. So there you are. Okay, we're going to my favorite music. We are going to Loretta Lynn, and these are my personal 45 records. And I'm going to play one that I love. We can't play big pieces of it because of copyright. Mm-hmm. So we're going to play a little bit of it. But I love that we have this little old record player. And here we go. This is one of my favorites. And I want y'all to sit back and tell me who was the artist that was singing with her. Y'all can text me, call me, whatever. And if you know... Because of copyright, we're going to be very cautious of how much we play, but that is one of my very, very favorites.
So here's my thing.
Yeah.
I know that we're doing it for YouTube and everything.
Yeah.
But I doubt their algorithm's even going to catch it. Because
then let's play some more.
Yeah.
Let's turn it over. Let's play another one of my favorites. And I will tell y'all, if you come to the cabin Friday and you tell me who is the artist singing with Loretta Lynn on this, you're going to get to win. You're going to get to win a Mr. LJ T-shirt. So come by the cabin and tell me. And again, I got to straighten it out. I lost a piece on my way up here, y'all, so we're improvising. Okay, same artist, and here you go.
Love is where you find. Just now struck 10. Darling, I had to call you to our favorite place again.
We know it's wrong for us to meet, but the fire's gone out at home, and there's nothing.
Wow.
If you come by the cabin Friday or Saturday and you can tell me who is that artist, and I will tell you. You know how rumors start.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Everybody assumed that because these two people did so well together that they must have been having an affair. No, they were not having an affair. They were the best of friends. And people always assume if you laugh and you cut up and you have a good time with somebody, you have to be having an affair, right?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Well, this lady and this man that were singing this song that happened to be duet of the year, year after year after year after year, mm-hmm. did not have an affair. They were the best of friends. But you know what was so strange? She was in the hospital with her husband at the same time her singing partner was in the hospital dying, which was really, really weird.
So, I mean, like, you can always have that spiritual connection with somebody mm-hmm. that, like, even though they're not blood, they become your family.
Right, like, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And that's what it's about. So as we look at today, you know, if you're an artist, I think about who was Blake Shelton married to, Miranda.
Yeah, Miranda.
Oh, my gosh, they were so amazing.
Oh.
They were amazing.
No, funny story about Blake Shelton. I saw him before he even got big at Lanierland.
Oh, yeah.
With
oh,
Andy
yeah.
Griggs.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
And he was so cool. Like, and then he mm-hmm. and Miranda ended up together, married, had the affair, da-da-da-da-da, whatever. And then now he's married to somebody else. So sometimes, yeah, sometimes he did meet somebody else. He married a rocker, which is really weird.
Gwen Stefani.
Yeah, and it's so crazy because sometimes those things do lead to affairs, but most of the time it's just a friendship and an amazing magical development mm-hmm. between somebody. So don't make, you know, the rumors about Miss Loretta and that gentleman never true. They were just the best of friends.
Yeah.
So yeah. Okay, now we're honoring Charley Pride, George Jones, Merle Haggard, and I found a song. I think this is so funny.
What was George Jones's nickname?
Oh, what was his? You want to give away another T-shirt if
sure.
they know his?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you will come to the cabin and tell me what was George Jones's nickname, then you will also win a Mr. Ella J T-shirt. Now here is, I think this is George Jones's greatest song. So, and I'm not going to tell you his, but here you go. George Jones' greatest song. What do you think?
No. You're using this all wrong.
Okay. What are we going to do?
You can have a list over right
oh,
here.
Oh, my gosh. You're getting all technical now. See? You have to have a techno geek up here. Okay. Now, recently, because Mr. Ella J happens to love to sing Merle Haggard songs, I'm hearing some Merle Haggard songs I've never heard. But this is a song that I heard often because Don's daddy sang it all the time. Wait a minute. Okay. Yeah. There you go. Maybe. There you go. Okay. All right. Now, this is Merle Haggard, and this is one that Don's dad sang all the time. He was the lead singer for a band. Uh-oh.
Started early. I can't see over it.
Yeah. We're having a hard time here, guys. Okay. We're going to
I don't have
it.
A track number.
Okay. Here we go. Uh-oh. Hang on.
Oh, it's actually worked.
Oh, my.
Look at the disc.
Did I mess up that record? I think I did something to the record player. Okay. Merle Haggard, you're not going to get to hear that one because it does sound pretty bad. But we're going to go back to probably the interview that I wanted to do the most, that I got to interview him by telephone. I did not get to go to Alabama and meet with Freddie Hart. Freddie Hart was like, that was the song, the CD that I went to every single day. And this is probably my favorite Freddie Hart song. And there are plenty of y'all out there who will say, well, that doesn't surprise me a bit, because he was so cool, he was so great, and he died as we were in conversation about doing an interview with him. And it was so sad because he was great. And I bet if somebody will come by the shop and tell me his song that was the first one, and you'll know it, that everybody loved, it's not this one, but I'm gonna get you to tell me. It's shifting. Okay. I lost a piece coming up here, y'all. So find me.
I just took a trip to heaven.
Yeah, I'm going to get the piece fixed for that. But this is not the song that Freddie Hart did, but if you can come by the cabin and tell me the song that Freddie Hart did that was... Everybody danced to this, slow dance to this, and it was like, it was an easy song to listen to. Mm-hmm. That's what I'll tell you. There's your hint. So come by the cabin and you're going to win a Mr. Ella J t-shirt.
All right, well, I'm going to stop your show.
You're going to do something. You told me you have a surprise.
I have a surprise for you.
I love it.
Is someone local who went to North Georgia College.
Mm-hmm.
They started a band up mm-hmm. there, and I don't know if you even know the full event that happened with them.
I don't.
Okay, so Trace, if you want to start that, and we'll play it all the way through.
It's loading now? Okay. While we're doing that, let me just say, out of everybody that we're honoring today, from Loretta Lynn, Charley Pride, George Jones, Merle Haggard, Billy Joe Royal, B.J. Thomas, Earl Thomas Conley, they are all singing in the Angel Band, but still here on Earth, living legends, Connie Smith, Donna Fargo, Aaron Tippin, there's so many mm-hmm. of those things. Gene Watson, when mm-hmm. I think about them, they're still here, so support their concerts.
And with Donna Fargo, like, I applaud her on her battle with MS.
Oh,
like,
my gosh. And this is Donovan and Donna Fargo. You look at that. Donovan as a child and Donna Fargo and Donovan's beautiful mamas. And, oh, my gosh.
That was Sandra's 2008?
Yeah. Isn't that precious?
Yeah, it was 2008.
Yeah. Just priceless. Just a priceless, priceless moment. And Donna Fargo has battled MS for many, many years. And then this is one of my favorite pictures of my beautiful daughter and I. And we had just done a parade. And I will just tell you, Angela would be so angry with me because I only did one parade this year. We used to do like four parades a year. And she'd say, Mom, come on, it's parade time. She loved doing parades. Mama, not so much. But anyway, that was just a fun day. And we've been talking about cancer all week. My daughter battled cancer and she beat the cancer, but she did not beat the depression. And that's pretty sad. There's so many people out there battling depression.
When Dwight gets the new car fixed, you yes. may be in parade mood.
Yes, 66 Chevelle, I'm going to be in a parade mood. Mm-hmm. And he better be in a driving mood. That's right. So, you know, I'm so blessed to be able to share these stories with y'all from Charley Pride, George Jones. If you're watching today and you haven't checked out our full YouTube channel, you can go see the Charley Pride interview, the George Jones. We didn't get to do a George Jones interview, but we did Connie Smith, Donna Fargo, Aaron Tippin, and Earl Thomas Conley was probably my favorite because the man did the interview with a temperature almost 105 degrees.
Do you know
so
who
sick.
Bought George Jones's tour bus?
No.
Leon Jones Trucking.
Oh, yes. David. Yeah. Yes. How cool is that?
Yeah. He had it. I don't know if they still have it, but wherever they went to go pick it up, They got me an autographed picture from George Jones.
I love that.
To Donavan Jones.
Oh, I love that. Yeah. I love that. That is so cool. That is so cool. When we're honoring the legends that are gone on, the legends that are still here, support your older country music artist. Do not forget that they pave the way for these new kids that are coming up that are changing country music.
Yeah, but also, like, the new stuff that's coming up is more mainstream.
Right.
Yes, there's a little bit of hip hop back behind it, but that's what people like and they want to go to concerts to, is to feel that.
Yeah.
So it's just a different era, but I mean, still remember where it came from.
Like, that's right.
Have that lineage, and you'll always have those memories of whenever you first heard
that song. Well, and nobody ever replaced Elvis Presley, but do you know who had more number one hits than Elvis Presley?
Who?
Conway Twitty.
I didn't know that.
Conway Twitty had 55 number ones. He still holds the world record for number one songs. Conway Twitty. It wasn't Elvis Presley. It wasn't the Beatles. It was Conway Twitty.
Yeah.
So how cool is that?
That's cool.
That is cool. That's really cool. Yeah. Okay, now Donovan has a surprise for me. So y'all sit back, and I don't know what we're going to see.
You don't
but
know
here we go.
About it.
America's Got Talent, the experience with it, how it happened, is kind of this crazy miracle story, just this totally random, once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, chance event that none of us were expecting, but completely changed the life of the band forever.
When I transferred to North Georgia and Zach McConnell asked me if I wanted to play bass in their bluegrass ensemble. So I was like, yeah, I'd love to do that. So I had to really learn how to play kind of the art of bluegrass pretty quick. I'm still learning. I'm still learning everything. But
and so I called Michael because I knew Michael was a great guitar player. And I said, hey, man, you know, here's an opportunity for you to play, get some exposure. You know, I'd love for you to be a part of this. And so he agreed, and he was really excited. And we had one rehearsal in Michael's apartment, and by the end of the night, you know, it was a four-hour jam session slash rehearsal. By the end of the night, we had like three or four songs down. In 2011, season 6, America's Got Talent came to Atlanta for the citywide auditions. 94.9 The Bull, which is a huge country station here in Georgia, based in Atlanta, was having this little contest, and the winner of this contest got a VIP audition to the city audition for Atlanta for America's Got Talent.
I actually didn't want to audition for America's Got Talent. My mom sent in a video to one of the local radio stations, and without my consent, and we ended up winning a special tryout where we didn't have to wait, so we just walked in and tried out.
We didn't even know they had sent it in, so we found out on a Friday and auditioned on Sunday.
It was really, really nice. We got down there, and it was at the Mart building down in downtown Atlanta, and our pitch was going to be, you know, that we were a bluegrass band that, you know, played pop music in instrumental form.
They liked us, but they said, you need a singer, which, you know, we totally understand, because we covered some pop songs just instrumentally, and that was kind of what our original niche would be. But we quickly realized that that wasn't enough.
So when we left that day, we were somewhat hopeful,
somewhat not hopeful. I was kind of neutral. I was like, you know what? If we didn't send in videos, it ain't going to break my heart. Because honestly, what are the chances of us actually making it on this show being who we are, right? But later that night, I gave Adam a call. And, you know, I said, hey, man, here's this opportunity. If they ever call us back, you know, would you be willing to do this? And he's like, yeah, man, sure. You know, it'd be fun. Which I was really scared because, you know, Adam's not the kind of guy that goes and tries out for American Idol.
I was literally reading lyrics off a whiteboard behind the camera. That's a true story.
First time we had ever played with each other.
I mean, the first time we'd ever tried to play with each other, the videos they were putting up to promote us, and I was like, oh, that is not good. That is not good.
That was the first time Adam had actually ever played with all of us. And they're still on YouTube, and some of them are our most watched videos. It's pretty interesting. Heard nothing for 2.5 months, almost 3 months. And then I'm sitting at work one day. I get a phone call from some guy with a British accent, or what I think is a British accent of some kind. And my immediate reaction is pure dread because I'm thinking something is wrong with our vacation, or like somebody's stolen my credit card information over there. Like, I just immediately felt panic stricken and started sweating, and you know, and so. Because this guy says, you know, is this Zach McConnell? I said, yes. And he said, my name's Nigel Cairo, and I'm one of the team producers from America's Got Talent. How are you today? And at that point, my mood completely changed, and I just kind of, like, lost my mind. I was like, oh, I think I'm going to be doing really, really well.
We did very well on the show, all things considered. Made 6 national television appearances. Got to play live twice in front of, you know, roughly 16 million people each time. And finished 25th overall. I think there, for the 6th season, there were about 57,000 acts. And that's well over 200,000 people who auditioned for the show total. So, you know, just 5 fairly immature boys from North Georgia making it that far with little to no preparation or practice, really, is kind of amazing.
Yeah, the first time we got voted off, I was just happy that we'd made it to where we did. The second time, I do remember a bit of just like 5 seconds of rage when I found out that we didn't make it. Because we were the last group to be judged by the judges at that point, so they actually were the ones that kicked us off, not America. So I did remember feeling a slight just tremor of rage just for a few seconds, then I realized, hey, it's okay.
When I was originally approached by like Trigvi and Zach and stuff, they wanted something to really like solidify the group as far as like tightening everything down. Because it was kind of, it wasn't like it was way all over the place, but it was just kind of, it was like everybody was kind of in their own thing, and they wanted like a drummer that just kind of came in and laid the foundation, so it brought the whole band together as one, if that makes sense.
So we're kind of shifting our approach now just because there's so many new opportunities for us. Just with the drums alone, now we can almost embrace any kind of music we want to. Does anybody else want to say anything?
Are you looking to actually make this a career, or is it just a hobby right now?
I mean, I think we want to make music a career.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yes. Yes. We want to make music a career.
Okay. I can just tell y'all, I'm so glad I wore a jacket today because I'm sitting here with cold chills running up and down my spine. I had no idea how that ended. Donavan, an Academy Award, an Emmy, a Telly, you should get every award for that. Yeah. What a life-changing experience for me to know that we are not guaranteed tomorrow. Mm-hmm. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. You did an amazing job.
Yeah.
That was, oh my gosh. Yeah.
That was my senior thesis whenever I was at SCAD. I released it. It's only been shown one time in public, and that was at the senior thesis show.
Mm-hmm.
Mom and Dad came down, and to hear, like, so two, I was developing the entire documentary, and it was all going to be about between dreams and reality, how these guys, a bunch of guys from North Georgia College, went to college to get normal jobs, but they've ended up on this path of music, and they could either live out their dream and play music, or they could get these normal jobs. One of them was an accountant, one of them did marketing, one of them went to college for on a tennis scholarship. So mm-hmm. It was like all these individual guys were just like, they had this opportunity that they could just grasp, and I was like, this is really interesting to me because that's been my whole life, is I want to reach out and live my dream, but right. I need to stay in reality too.
Yep.
And so I started the entire process. My brother played basketball with the guitar player, and so I sat down with them, did all the interviews and everything, and then I start editing the actual documentary, start turning it in for little benchmarks for my classes and stuff. And then I get 2 weeks before it's due for the final showcase, I get a phone call that Zach had passed away.
Oh my gosh.
It was like a big heart drop. It's like, what happened?
Yeah.
He passed away from a heart murmur.
Yeah.
And so, that all happened. I was just like, I've got to change my entire documentary. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how I'm going to end it. And I was like, what's that feeling I got whenever I got that phone call? And it was like, I brought you to a point of emotions of like, these guys are going to go somewhere.
And then
tragedy happens. But I will say,
my gosh,
we're not promised tomorrow by any means, and it's like, live just for today.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I live by that now more than ever.
Wow, thank you so much. This is such a tribute. We are going to go now to a commercial break. Please pay attention to our sponsors. Without them, we wouldn't be here. So we're going to take a commercial break. When we come back, we're going to talk about something very local that the opportunity just didn't arise to do what should have been done. But we're going to talk about that when we come back.
Whether you're in the mood for chicken strips, a delicious burger, our classic banana split, or an upside-down thick blizzard treat, we've got you covered. Hot and fresh food every day, every time. And delicious DQ soft serve make the perfect pair at your favorite place. Not fast food, fan food fast. Your Blue Ridge, Ella J, and Jasper Dairy Queens are your meat, eat, and treat headquarters.
Thank you for choosing DQ. How may I serve you?
United Country Talking Rock Realty says, welcome to North Georgia. The leaves are falling and the mountains are calling. Take the back roads and really get to know North Georgia.
Combine the amazing workmanship of SGC Groups, transforming the forgotten to the fabulous. Teamwork makes the dream work. For buying, selling, or flipping, call Sherry Martin at 404-375-0590 or Evelyn Calhoun at 770-733-0779.
Whether you're swimming in the sea or splashing in the pool, making a masterpiece, or just making memories, writing a great American novel, or writing your term paper that's due tomorrow. Whatever you do in life, Farmers is here to protect it. For all your insurance needs, call Donald Curtis in Blue Ridge.
Georgia Medical Treatment Center now has two locations to bring you the high-quality, holistic care you've come to know and expect. We treat neck, back, and joint pain with chiropractic care and injection-based treatment without the need for surgery or prescription painkillers. Our medical weight loss program can also provide relief while ridding your body of toxins, pounds, and inches while improving your overall health. Call today for a free consultation, 770-345-2000, or go online to georgiamtc.com.
High-speed Wi-Fi. Not quite as important as running water in your home, but close. Ignite Internet from ETC powers your Wi-Fi network with consistent speeds to keep all your gadgets going strong. Streaming video players, laptops, tablets, even smartphones, so you're never stuck with those big cell data charges. And talk about value. Just pick your speed and keep the Wi-Fi flowing in your home at a great low price. Upgrade your Internet today. Call or visit etcnow.com to learn more.
Wow, that's all I can say. Wow, young man, great job, great job. Okay, today we're going to share just a blippet of one of the interviews. I was lucky enough to interview Charley Pride. He suddenly died of COVID. So sad. George Jones died. Merle Haggard died. Billy Joe Royal died. We have lost so much talent. But to see that young man with his future just ahead of him, that was a curveball. That was a curveball. And what an amazing story and what an amazing... But we want to go to one of my interviews. Then we're going to come back and we're going to end with something very, very special.
Hey, I'll tell you right quick. I don't usually pay attention to him, but I can tell you something about your music. I don't know anybody who wasn't touched by some of it. And we were talking yesterday about our favorite songs. And we all had such different ideas of favorite songs. My favorite is All I Have to Offer You Is Me.
That was my first number one.
I absolutely fell in love with that song, and I wore it out playing it. Does Charley Pride have a favorite song?
Yeah.
Which one?
Yes, the one I'm singing at the moment.
Okay, well, that's pretty cool.
And
that's pretty cool.
That's not just I'm making an answer, but it's the truth. For example, we go to Ireland, and we have to kind of interchange song. For example, Crystal Chandeliers was never a single, but I've been doing it in my show all these years. When I go to, they released it in Ireland as a single about two or three times. I get ready to do that song, it's Oh, the Crystal, the Walls Tremble.
Oh, wow.
So I'm loving doing that song.
Yeah.
I go to Australia, New Zealand, they got, On the Wings of a Song. So I love singing when I'm singing that. So whatever I'm singing at the moment wasn't just said out of trying to be Smith's, but about it. This is the truth. I've been blessed with being able to do songs from albums that people love more than they do.
Okay, there he was, Charley Pride, a living legend, and then COVID ended his life suddenly. Charley Pride was one of those entertainers still entertaining at the last days of his life, and that's what today we want to focus on, the end of your life, the days of your life, the important parts of your life. When I brought Dwight Sanford on board, y'all all just fell in love with him immediately. And everybody said, oh, what a fresh idea, oh, what a fresh, great, this is wonderful.
Yeah.
But during getting to know him, I have been very disappointed in the fact that his music didn't go national.
Right.
Because he is an amazing writer, he is an amazing, amazing singer, and he can play guitar like anybody. Mm-hmm. I mean, just amazing. But it was that one opportunity. And the group that you followed, they got that one opportunity.
Yeah.
Twice they got that one opportunity. And they went national. They went national. They had millions of viewers. If that had happened to our local boy, Dwight Sanford, he would not be Mr. Elijah. He would be Mr. Worldwide.
Right.
And that's kind of heartbreaking to me, because if you have that amazing talent and you can't get that one break, you know, that one break. Robbie Hopkins, who lives over in Chatsworth, one of my dear friends, I adore him. We had him here on the show. He is an amazing writer. He is an amazing singer. His boys are singing backup with him now and doing guitar. His twin boys, he's amazing, but he hasn't had that one break.
Right.
And Donavan, you see that all the time.
Oh, all the time.
You meet talented people who don't get that break.
It's just like the title of the documentary is Between Dreams and Reality.
Yes,
like
exactly.
Like we're always sitting in, everyone is sitting between what we could and what we want and what we need and what we were given.
Right.
And it's
right.
All about timing and what God has planned for us. And he, I mean, he don't make junk, one thing.
Right.
Also, like, he doesn't put anything in your life that you can't handle at that moment. Mm-hmm. I've had, you know, my story and everything. Like, when my mom passing, like...
When your mom passed away, I couldn't believe your mom passed away. And I still have this hard time with it. I couldn't believe, because she was so much younger than me. And so, you know, she was on top of everything.
Oh, she was on top of everything. And then she passed away. Like, right up until before she went into the hospital with leukemia, she was having trouble with her heart and everything. And finally, the doctor figured out what was going on and sent her down to Northside. And then that was end of March, beginning of April. Spent my last birthday there, April 26th, inside the hospital with her. Luckily, at the time, I was between jobs. Like, this is the thing that just...
God has a plan.
God has a plan for everything. Yeah. I quit my job in 2017 and started working on my own freelancing. And then Mom went into the hospital the beginning of 2018. I was able to be there every single
perfect
day.
Perfect timing. God's perfect timing.
And if I had a job that I couldn't do that, I think I would have been worse off afterwards.
Oh, yeah. Many regrets.
The grief definitely would have gotten me even worse.
Yeah.
But now, like, being able to, like, process everything and work through everything, like, I know that she would want me happy, and I'm doing what she wants me to do.
I tell you every day? Go for your dreams.
Yeah, go for your
dreams. Do not stop anywhere that is a roadblock. Mm-hmm. Go for your dreams, because you are so super talented.
Yeah.
And you have the ability to change somebody's life. I mean, you just changed our viewers' lives, because people were sitting at home watching this, and nobody had any idea how this was going to end. I had no idea how it was going to end. And you just changed lives, because you taught people that we are not guaranteed tomorrow. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. Well, we're going to end today, and we got to go right now and do it, because I want you to listen to... This was written by a local. He was a police officer here. He was a school bus driver here. He was the leader of the band here, Dwight Sanford. This song was written by him, and there's no reason it should not have gone national. So this is my favorite. And today, because he's not here to tell me I can't do it, I want you to just listen, and I want you to come and pick up the CD that says, I've Been Wrong Before. Here we go.
The bank says it's foreclosing, and the pickup needs repair. The LP tank's on zero, and my wheel is almost there. The hope I had left with you when you walked out the door, I would say things can get worse, but I've been wrong before. The postman brought a letter. He said he needs my signature. He don't know you had to go, and the way you left me here. I told him I don't love you, but the Lord knows I still do. And he knows just what I feel inside and the things I'm going through. My brother said there's a bottle that'll make this go away. I could drink until it's over or until my dying day. I could do all this until
the message on my phone. I called in to talk to him to see what's going on. They're laying off across the plant, employees by the score. I would say things can't get worse, but I've been wrong before. And I could turn to the bottle and make this go away. I could drink until it's over, or until my dying day.